Action.
$150,000 for immigrants to buy a home in California. Man, I said, hold up, wait a minute. Let me put some immigrant in it, okay? If I look like an immigrant, maybe they'll give me $150,000 too. How about that?
I'm light-skinned, man. I get mistaken for everything but black.
Man, they call me Cuban. I know a little bit of Spanish. Let me get some of that money too. Everyone wants me to be for immigration because I'm a black man. And so I have an agreement with every immigrant in America. I will be for immigration if you're for reparations. How about that? If we're going to have a political alliance in America, then we got to work together, huh? Right.
I just don't understand what's the holdup on taking care of the American citizens you have here, and what's the push on supporting immigration. I mean, and let's be very specific. This is $150,000 to undocumented immigrants.
Hey, so
Does that even go down?
So look, I just showed you that I'm an immigrant also, and now I qualify for the $150,000 they're giving away to immigrants. Let's have that conversation, please. But now I'm back to being the greatest American alive, America, the greatest nation on earth. Everyone wants to run here and get all the money here, but then they don't want to celebrate what makes this place so great. You hear me?
What do you mean by that? What's not being celebrated? And I'm just asking so you can go more in depth.
The black folks that made it possible for them to even be here. The people who sacrificed their lives for the civil rights movement, for them to have the opportunity to come and join all this freedom, they don't want to celebrate that. But if you come over here, you celebrate Cinco de Mayo. The Indians, they come over here, they maintain all of their customs and traditions from their homeland. And then you look at me and I say, black folks in America who actually built this thing and suffered in this place deserve reparations. You'd be like, no reparations. But when they offer you some money, you sure do take it. And you don't think about me. Every time I want to talk about what happened to me at my people in America, I'm a descendant of an American slave. They want to say, but there was slavery everywhere. There was slavery everywhere.
Then who owns the stores, the convenience stores in our community? It's old food in there. All that money is being siphoned out of our community and it's going somewhere else. Do we get the bank loans to be able to open up corner stores, food marts? Do we get that? Are we privy to that? Where are the loans that will help underprivileged black people? Where is it? Where is the aid that black people have? This is my issue with immigration. Yes. My only issue with immigration is this.
Tell me.
What we've provided, what we fought for all non-white people, which was really preserved for us, has gone to everybody but us. All the amenities of civil rights has gone everywhere else.
The thing that makes it so offensive is that Kamala Harris, she made a statement and she specifically said that she was not going to make any policy specifically for black people, but only for Americans. But how about these immigrants, right? You make specific policies just for these immigrants. How does that benefit and pertain to me? And now when I ask you that question, all of a sudden I'm saying something that's inflammatory because I want everything about politics is the fight for resources. And so how dare you just show up to this country, the place that our grandparents, our great grandparents dedicated their lives to this place. And we're continuing. We're both veterans of the United States military, serve this nation. And instead of you looking at me as a first class citizen, I mean, an actual American citizen, you look at me like I'm some third world person. And that offends me.
And what happens with this issue is it's very easy to be flipped into a racial divide, because here's the truth. We have Mexican Americans who were born here, who are citizens of this country, but because of their ethnicity, it gives them a cultural alliance. I don't think this is across the board for all Mexican people that are in this country that are citizens, but for quite a few of them, that alignment with this immigration issue, because many of our Mexican American brothers and sisters have had immigration from their families, or their mothers and fathers have immigrated here. That is fine.
I'm not here to fight for their plight, man. Like, you're here already. And so you have the ability to have political movements, and you do have political movements. And without Mexicans in America, does anyone have to pander to them and say, be a conservative or be a Democrat or Republican? Do you see that? Do you see
that
type of advertisements?
No,
does anyone? If you hear a Mexican, if a Mexican man says, I'm a Republican, do you look
Nobody
at him differently?
Cares. Nobody
cares. The Mexican man says, I'm a Democrat. Do you look at him differently?
Did you hear about that town? It was a border town, too, where, like, most of the population that eventually got, like, I guess you would call it naturalized, they became citizens. They eventually turned conservative.
Because most people in the world are conservative people. They believe in family values. They believe in working hard, creating a community, and sustaining that community with the participation of the groups in the community. But they don't want big government to come in and say, you have to do this. If I give you a dollar, then you I own you, and you have to do what I tell you to do. That's insanity.
And going back to that point about making it a racial divide, I think securing the borders is not just about Mexico, even though primarily the immigration population is from Mexico.
I don't know how knowledgeable you are about the global society, but how many nations have open borders? How many nations can you just show up with no passport, no documentation, and they just let you into their country and say, man, here goes $150,000. If that was the case, let me just go to China and say, hey, China, how about y'all give me $150,000? Hey, Germany, how about y'all just give me $150,000? I'm a black refugee from America. The police are hunting us down in disproportionate numbers to as it pertains to the scale of our society. And I feel like I'm being persecuted. Can I get can I be a refugee to Germany, please?
There are no statistics that show that once you naturalize the people that were immigrants, that they're going to vote for the Democratic Party. In fact, there's a lot of evidence pointing to the fact that they may turn conservative. I don't understand what's the agenda from the Democratic Party that is pushing for keeping these borders open. And listen, when you report stuff like that, when news like that is coming out, it makes Trump look less insane, less crazy. I was calling the man crazy, but
I heard these people say, I don't know exactly where it came from, but someone said that Islam is going to be the predominant religion in America in like the next 25 years. Because Christianity, I mean, if you just let everybody do whatever, then you don't stand for anything. And so why am I going to go to a church when the pastor is just trying to make some money and he has there is no moral ground to stand on whatsoever? And so these Islamic people, they're coming here and they're staying, they're remaining devout Islamic people. And they're building communities and they're having political action. And so the Democrats, they tried to pander to this group of people up north, somewhere like Minnesota or something, where they have a real stronghold. And they're conservative people because they're like, hold on, man, how are you going to tell my son and my daughter that they can be a different gender than what they were born? How dare you interfere in my family?
I'm going to be honest with you, and this might get a little dangerous. I don't even feel that the Mexican immigration is what's dangerous. I think it's the immigration from other countries. I think that we're hiding behind our Mexican-Americans being here.
Dangerous.
Dangerous in what you just said. I mean, hey, let's be honest. You have Islamic extremists. We've dealt with this in the past. You have mosques popping up. What do you think is going to happen? I mean, when you see these other communities that have absolutely no allegiance, absolutely no allegiance to this country, coming here, setting up entire neighborhoods, setting up their community here, that's an issue. We have other people that have absolutely no allegiance to this country. That is very dangerous to have on the soil.
It sounds like your premise is that, in general, Mexicans like black folks. Is that what you're saying?
I think in general, and I'm just being honest, not only that, I think they have a certain amount of allegiance to this country that's really not destructive, if I'm being honest. I think it's the other people coming here where it could be dangerous, where you can have terrorist cells setting up. Let's be honest. I'm from Houston. I've grown up with Mexican people. My barber is Mexican. Like, he cuts my beard. Like, we have a cultural alignment and identification with Mexican people to where I don't think that's our issue.
I think it's proximity based on economics, while culturally they look at our culture, and Mexican men tell their daughters do not date black men, and Mexican mothers tell their daughters the exact same thing. Do they disobey? Yes, they do.
Do you think that's happening in Houston?
Yes, absolutely. 1,000%.
I love you, Kevin. Bro. That boy gonna come with it. I just don't think that's our issue. I think that's where the racism comes in, and that's what makes it hard to actually say, hey, guess what? You Mexican-American, you need to seal these borders. And if anybody wants to come here, they need to be naturalized in a certain order. I like this conversation.
Yvette Carnell, I like to reference her because she be sitting there. If you're not interested in facts, it's going to be kind of boring. Does she have is she biased? Of course she is. She believes what she believes.
I love Yvette Carnell.
And I think you're supposed to fight for what you believe. While simultaneously, hey, Mexican Americans, they fought very hard not to be aligned with black people politically. They made sure their birth certificates, they don't say no nigga, baby. It says white. And so like every other group of people, whether you're German or Irish or whatever European nation you came from, Mexicans wanted to identify the exact same way. They wanted to assimilate to whiteness. I know there's one America. Yeah. But everyone in America, they don't want to be black. They don't want to be black. And that's an uncomfortable truth. And you'll sit there and say it's not about race while simultaneously you don't want to come live where I live at. And simultaneously, you don't want to build where I live at. You don't want to make this a better place for these people because you don't give a shit about these people. But then you expect me to give a shit about your people. And I think that's a conflict of interest. So, hey, all my Mexican friends, I love you to death, right? And since I love you, I'm for immigration. Now, if you love me, get up on a microphone and tell them how much you believe I'm supposed to get reparations. You tell them how much you love that's black true. Folks the same way I just said how much I love you. Tell your truth. Man, my best friend, that's my homie, right? And I think that him and his family deserve reparations because they're descendants of American slaves.
I do believe it needs to be a brown and black political alignment. I've actually said this. I don't know if I've said this on a podcast yet, but I think we would benefit from it. I think that's where real political alignment needs to be. However, comma, I can't deny that I have not seen that political alignment yet, especially when it comes to reparations and black issues. But I have... It's not the few. We know we're going to have a few. Like, you have a few friends that believe in what you believe in may not be racist. We're talking about holistically, y'all. So y'all got to understand, because it's very easy to be like, well, my homie.
Let's talk about friend. Houston, right? In yeah. Houston, if you go down Harwin, it's called like the Gandhi district or something like
yes,
that.
Yes, man.
And these people, Indian people, own their property and they yes. own where they do commerce at. You really don't have to see a whole bunch of Indian politicians. When you own the place where you do business at, when you own the homes you live in, you have political power without telling somebody to come vote. You don't hear no Indians talking about vote. You don't hear no Chinese people talking about vote. You don't hear no Mexicans talking about this is what I'm voting for. They own they shit. The government can't tell them shit because they own they shit. We go down to Chinatown right there to Meyerland, and they got Chinese signs and shit.
Yeah.
I ain't got no nigga signs but you know, over here.
One of the issues that's discussed, at least with Mexicans, is that they don't vote. But I'm not sure if they even have the same power of the groups you just said.
Yeah, just say that.
The Gandhi dish, dog, I've seen, like, it's ridiculous how they have that. This is what I'm talking about.
Say the thing that you just said. Like, you said it, and you don't even know that you said it. You said they don't vote.
They don't vote.
But they still have political power, and they still get... Their families still get American dollars. They still drop these anchor babies. And ain't nobody making them go away.
I think they being played with.
The hardest people, the hardest person on the immigrant in the last 50 years was Barack Obama.
I'm going to tell you why I think they being played with.
He deported
because
like 3 million
they're
immigrants.
They're still battling gentrification like us. Like, if you look at the neighborhoods where they've predominantly been, it's being gentrified. We're not gentrifying those other neighborhoods you just talked about. This is what I think is happening with Mexican Americans. What they're saying is we're hoping.
Bro, they're getting rich.
We're hoping that you come vote and start voting.
Brother, they're getting rich.
You think financially they're hit? Well, black people are at the bottom.
I don't think. I know.
Black people at the bottom.
They're coming
of the
over here and they're getting federal funding and they're getting rich. Every state has a budget for immigration. They're coming over here and they get into the bag and they look at me and say, why can't you do it? Hey, they wrote laws to stop me and they paying you. When you incentivize something, they going to do it. Why the hell you think we had all these immigrants at our border? They said they paying motherfuckers to show up respectfully.
America, why do you hate black people so much?
They ain't going to tell you.
Can you please tell us?
They ain't going
to
tell you.
We don't have a country to go back to. This is our country. We built it. We came here when you came here. Why do you not like black Americans? Because I'm going to tell you something. You might have seen this comment from, I'm not going to even put his name out on Facebook.
He hit it though. What's up? What he said?
He's white. And he saw the immigration post I put up. And he was like, this is how he phrased it. I would rather see the money, because I put reparations up there saying they don't have no money for reparations. Caption to the immigration thing. He was like, I would rather see the money go to American citizens. However, I don't like this. So it was a however to it. It's like, you know, I would rather see it. It was like, dude, you would rather see it. Why not just be for it?
Put a name on it. DJ Vlad said reparations should only go to black people if it was in the form of education or something like that. As if all black people are dumb and they need to go to school. If there has been a financial grievance on a group of people, America has repaid them with finances. The Jewish people, when they put Japanese people in internment camps, they paid these people. They're still paying the Native American right now. And so after COVID happened, right, that COVID affected it killed less than 1% of the people who contracted COVID, right? And for this thing, they shut down the world for like a year and a half or something like this. And the American government, they spent over $6 trillion for 1% of the total population. You go argue with your mama. It's facts, right?
It's so funny because I'm pulling that. I want to start pulling up facts.
And so when they spend $6 trillion on this invisible thing that all of a sudden they say it just went away. they paid companies to sell you a product. And then when the product harmed American citizens, what was the recourse? What could you do? They made laws that said that you couldn't even sue them because of the national emergency. And now you disrespect the black people so much because I started talking about DJ Vlad. DJ Vlad said, pay them in education. And then he saw how much money they spent on COVID. He was like, man, they could have paid for reparations because his argument was.
That's what he said?
Yeah, yeah. Because it was obvious they could have. The United States government, they bought out the entire financial system in the crash of like 2008. They've been burning money in the face of American citizens, specifically poor people, more specifically black Americans who are owed a debt.
Here's the oldest
and greatest debt in American
history.
Here's
where we fail ourselves, though. We have not come together. I've said this before. We have not come together. The intellects have not come together.
Yes, they have.
And put this in such a form. Who?
The Boule. The talented 10th. The most bestest, most proudest, and most prestigious Negroes in America.
And they've talked about reparations?
They talked about lining their pockets with as much money as they possibly could. Every time you seen a black person get some power for their people, they line their pockets. Black Lives Matter.
You see what he did there?
The NAACP. They went and got the bag.
Why
they went and got
the bag.
I'm just saying, bro. That has served us as the nastiest stuff in the world. Man, Michelle Obama and Oprah Winfrey went on stage talking about they were suspicious of rich people. Michelle Obama's worth $140 million and Oprah's worth over $1 billion. And they said they suspicious of rich people.
How did Obama and Michelle get that much money? And like, where did that come from?
Man, they wrote a bunch of books.
Hey, first off, and shout out to Yvette Cornell for pointing this out too. Obama really doesn't have a real true black American lineage. I mean, well, he had like a $500,000 trust fund.
Black American, you can't be no black American if you're a damn Nigerian.
Yeah, his daddy from, yeah.
Your mama white. Yeah. And so your connection to America is whiteness.
And your sister, India, Indonesia, something like that.
Your connection to America is whiteness.
Mm-hmm.
Your connection to America isn't blackness. When he gave his speeches, he talked about being at his grandparents' home and how his grandparents' home was just like every American's home. They have like little tchotchkes and stuff on the wall, you know what I'm saying? The little dogs that are sad and precious moments and ugly furniture. It's just... This is how he's connected. And to point that out, they tried out this Indian woman and they say that she's black and all these black women are cheering for this person. Immigrant is the new black. Vivek Ramaswamy called himself a person of color. What the hell is a person of color?
What is that?
Obviously, it's not me, because if that's him, he gets to be a person of color while simultaneously being an immigrant of descendant of Indian parents, right? They came from over there, over yonder, where they're like curry and things of this nature. He gets to have the full American experience. Now, I've been here my whole life. And hey, y'all just now try to recognize me as a whole human being.
Then you have signs that are up now saying you don't have to be a Jew to protect or have, you know, to fight against anti-Semitism. You're seeing this on billboards. Okay, I agree with that. You don't have to be black to fight for reparations. Everybody who is non-black keeps telling us why we shouldn't get reparations.
How come
that's crazy.
How come so many individual Jewish people own so many black people? And I say that through contract language. I didn't say all Jews own all black people. That'd be crazy for me to say that. You might say that was Kanye West, but I'm not Kanye West. I'm the greatest American alive. You're the greatest American alive. You should ask questions on why a small nation in the middle of the Middle East has so much influence over your government. How come they get $3.5 billion every year in defense funding so they can have wage war on brown-skinned people? Why is that? Why is that?
Everybody wants to use the black movement for their own agenda, but nobody wants to reward the black people from which it came from. We put our lives into this. Hey, bloodshed has happened over decades and decades of us fighting just to be able to go have a piece of pie in a fucking institution where white people are. We fought for that. All for you guys to abuse it and actually use it to get rich. And guess what? When you talk about poverty, when you talk about out of wedlock births, we are worse. We are at the bottom of all of this. We have a destroyed community.
Let me tap into that.
Go ahead.
There are more white women on welfare than there are black people in America.
That's crazy. Those are real stats, by the way.
There are more white women having babies outside of wedlock than there are black women having babies outside of wedlock. But y'all like to say, by the percentages. Yeah, exactly. But on pure numbers, there are more white women having more out of wedlock babies than there are black women, huh? But you say, man, by the percentages, since there's so many of you in your demographic, then you're just so terrible. Man, it's more of y'all. There are more poor white people in America than there are black people in America.
But
there are more poor white people in America than there are black Americans in America.
Do you think the government won't give us reparations because white people will find it offensive?
Yes.
That's what I think, too. That's what I think, too. Because it lifts us. It literally, if you give us reparations, that takes us out of poverty.
So since you're not going to give us reparations, you'll just give immigrants everything that they could ever ask for and just laugh in a nigga's face. And I'm supposed to just take it. That's a tough pill to swallow. And all of my friends, I got Indian friends. I got all types of immigrant friends. And how many of you are going to post give black folks reparations immediately? How many of you going to say that?
I mean, obviously, you can go to my post and see my friends who are non-black don't agree with reparations. I'm going to say this.
And then you find out who your friends really are.
White man, black man. This is in-house fighting. If it does not cease, that's how you lose the country. You're afraid of somebody coming to take over your country, but your hate and disdain for the black American is so vast and large. That's how you're going to give this country up. You need to fix that.
Man, you say that, and I can't put my destiny into another person's hands. Mm-hmm. I can look at black representatives, and I can look at myself. I got to negotiate on my own behalf. When I'm talking to a man, I got to talk to this person like a man. And I expect you to talk to me like a man, or else me and my people are going to have an elongated conversation about how we negotiate resources in America. That's how power looks, right? When you show up with your people and I show up with my people and we negotiate effectively on how we divide these resources, every time a black person got into a position of power, they just took the bag. They took the side bag. They took the brown paper bag. Hey, niggas, y'all pray. Barack Obama literally told men in America, told black men in America, as he passed gay rights, as he passed all these other bills that gave people money in the first 100 days. Barack Obama, he had a program called My Brother's Keeper, and he told, hey, black boys, y'all lift each other up. Hey, black men, you look after each other, and I'm my brother's keeper. And he played on the black gospel connection when he ain't even that. Every time a nigga got into a jam, he just pretended to be black. He sang some Marvin Gaye to try to get out of a jam. He's a fucker, man. It's the same way Bill Clinton. He went on the senior hall and played the saxophone.
And played the saxophone.
Said, that's my president. Y'all like some trivial stuff, don't you?
I'm glad you brought this up. Niggas, y'all love entertainment way too much. That's the only way to communicate with y'all. We'll say this, and y'all may comment, y'all may say a little bit. But as soon as we talked about the tits and chain of the fake Dr. Bryant, oh, y'all was in the comments. Anytime we talk about entertainers or saying something, y'all flocking to it. It don't take much to get black folk distracted by talking about entertainment. All you got to do is play and dance and jig and do a little dance, and y'all are on board whatever that political plight agenda may be. Y'all are all for that. Y'all don't take in good information. That's why we are to blame for not getting this all the way through, because guess what? How do we choose our leaders?
Our debauchery is our calling card. They not like us. They not like us. They don't wear wigs like us. They don't gangbang like us.
Oh,
how about
come on.
That?
Let's go then.
Man, I'm just saying. What,
yeah, let's go.
We want to own everything that's not good in America and claim that shit to be ours. Man, if you go to a soul food restaurant, you finna get food that's literally gonna kill you.
Ah, man.
Grease and shit.
I was told in the comments not to go to Atlanta. Black people are always trying to put a no-fly zone on other black people, but you can't put a no-fly zone on police brutality. You can't put a no-fly zone on how you're being treated by other groups in this country. But we're going to always do something bad to each other. All the time.
You telling me that all these powerful people in all these urban areas, they don't have the ability to stop police from harassing them?
Come on.
They ain't got that type of political power. You mean these millionaire black men, these moguls, can't stop the CIA and the FBI from raiding their homes? Huh? All these people are very wealthy brand ambassadors who say, yes, nigga, drink more Hennessy. You need more cognac. You need more vodka. I need you to be numb to the fact that America really doesn't love you. And immigrants, they know that America doesn't love you. And so all they have to do is pretend to be a better version of you. Every immigrant in America, you a nigga 2.0 because you're standing on the shoulders of giants. You ain't did it. We did it. And you're going to try to omit me. I'm going to rewrite history in my own words. I'm going to fight for my ancestors because I'm an American, a descendant of an American slave. And there's a white man back there, too, somewhere.
We're the greatest Americans alive.
The greatest American alive.
The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive. The greatest American alive.